At the age of seven, that was the very first time I saw this instrument, the keyboard. And it was my uncle that brought it. And so even at that age, I didn't even know the name. I knew it as that object that is black and white. And as a little boy, I couldn't explain myself. I was confused. I was to explain it. Nobody understood me. It was 5 years later that I saw the instrument again. Remember, I was seeing, I was not touching. And so, the long and short of the story is that eventually, God helped me and I learned how to play this instrument. But why and what would I have to use these instruments for? When I was this age, when I was very young, all I knew is that I knew how to sing, I knew how to dance, I knew how to do this, I knew how to do that. But what is it that this could be used for in the right way? Now, this particular part, the musical part of life, is what a lot of people have misunderstood. And when I was given this opportunity to speak, I decided that I would tell and reveal to the people of God things about this music from the scripture. Now, let us start with this definition. What is music? In my junior secondary school, we define music as organized sound, which means any other sound that is not organized is noise. And so, once it is music, which means the keyboard doesn't have to be there for it to be organized. We can be clapping and be dancing and be singing. We are making music. But when you start making sounds that are not in accordance with what you're singing, you're making noise. Okay, now, so music is organized sound. Any other thing apart from this is noise. Before I go into the scripture, I want to ask, honestly, sincerely, all these things we hear, some of this music we hear nowadays, some of this music we hear nowadays, are these really pieces of music or just noise? When I hear something like I don't really know all these songs, but there are some of these songs that I call people and tell people, see, this is not music. This is what I call rhythmical noise. Noise that is organized. Now, that is the third one. It is an organized noise. I told them, number one, any music, anything that does not give to God in a melodious form is not music. Number two, anything that does not change the life of somebody in its melodious form is not music. And when I say this, a lot of people will start arguing with me. And being the kind of person that will not like to argue too much, I keep quiet. Because most of the things I hear are just not encouraging at all. You will hear somebody enter the studio and use 4 minutes to describe the buttocks of a woman. And we call that music. You hear somebody enter and, you know, sing things from the head to the toes of a woman. And we call that music. And people are by. And we are dancing. And we call that music. But in a situation where you sing something like, lift up your hands and say, amazing grace, how sweet the sound, people will start leaping. Of course, it is that way. People are so bored with things that are good. People are so bored with music that can change your life. Music is supposed to change life. If music does not touch life, you're wasting time. It is a waste of time. Now I am going to move us to the Bible now. How did music begin? Bible recorded in the book of Genesis chapter 4 verse 21 that Jubal was the father of all those who played the stringed instruments and the pipes. That is where music began, in the earth. But in heaven, we know that the organizer of music was Lucifer. Am I correct?
Yes.
He organized music in heaven. So when began to enter him, he thought about overthrowing that, and so he was fought against, and he was brought down from heaven. Now, being the master of music, he knew how to play every instrument, if I must say. So the devil is a talented somebody in music. He said, I must use my talent to make the people of God move away from God. And that is why the most powerful satanic group in the world today has relationship with music. Am I correct? We have Illuminati. Almost every member of them are singing. And when they are singing, they are encoding the eulogy of the devil. They are encoding, like, they are praising the devil in their songs without our knowledge. And so this is the means that the devil is using to make sure that the people of God are moving away from God without our knowledge. He is the master of music, so you cannot deceive him in music. Devil has lived for over 6,000 years plus. And so nobody in this world nobody is stronger than the devil. You are greater than the devil. Bible says he that is in you is greater than the devil. So nobody is greater than the devil. He is also a spiritual being. And so for you to think you can deceive the devil, you are simply deceiving yourself. So take note, the people of God, that music is not child's play. No matter how free we are when we play music, we have to be cautious what we say, what we do. It is not an anyhow business, because the devil is watching. The devil is watching. And is using every single opportunity he gets to make the people of God sway, to move away from the trail, from the rail, sorry. So, what does God think about music? Psalm chapter 150. Psalm 150. This part of the psalm is the psalm that explains how one must praise God. So number one is that music is used to praise God. Am I correct? Music is used to praise God. I will tell you what praising God, what using music to praise God can do. And I'll show you in the Bible. But Psalm 150, praise God. Praise God in his sanctuary. Him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his act of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet, number one. Praise him with the harp and lyre, number two. Praise him with the tambourine and dancing, number three. Praise him with the strings and the fives, number four. Praise him with the clash of cymbals, number five. With resounding cymbal, number six. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. So who is allowed to praise God? Everything that has breath. Everything that has breath. Your goat, your dog, your chicken, human beings, trees. Everything that has breath. Bible says, if you will not praise me, I will raise stones to praise me. And we that are greedy, personally, I will not allow stones to praise God while I'm alive. No. And as long as God has given me what I have to praise him, I will praise him. If God has given me the feet to dance and has not given me the voice to sing, I will use my feet to dance to the glory of God. Now, why should we praise God? In my early teenage years, my mom taught me and said, there is something you must learn, my boy. Prayer. When you pray to God, God will send his angels. But when you praise God, God will come down himself. It's in the Bible. You see? Take Acts of Apostles chapter 16 verse 25 to 30. At midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. We're doing what? Praying and singing hymns to God. And the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaking. At once, all the prison doors flew open and every chain came loose. And then the jailer woke up and he saw that the prison doors opened. And he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But Saul, don't harm yourself, we are all here. The jailer called for light and rushed in, fell trembling before Paul and Silas, and then brought about them and asked, sir, what must we do to be saved? Remember, where this started was in the same chapter, but in verse 16, where they had to cast out the spirit of Python from a young lady who was using it for, the parents of the girl were using it for money. They were making money through the young lady's evil, diabolic divinations. So, Paul and Silas knew that this was not from God, and so they commanded that spirit to leave. In the name of Jesus. And what happened? They caught the two young men and put them in prison. Now, in prison, what they were doing is that they prayed and sang. And what happened here cannot be explained naturally. Bible says the foundation of the house shook. God had come down himself. The foundation of the house shook. The doors flung open. I mean, they were uprooted from their hinges and they opened. That could not be explained by ordinary explanation. It had no explanation at all. There was no way that could be explained. But that is one thing praise can do for you. That is one thing that giving God praise can do for you. So, rather than using music to do something else, why not come to the presence of God? Kneel before him. Stand before him. Sit before him. Raise your hands. Worship God. And go home. And God will take care of things himself. It is not that prayer is not okay. Nobody is saying prayer. Prayer is wonderful. 100%. I'm just dwelling on the path of praise, where God can come down himself. I love that part. Anytime I'm praying, I choose to sing. When I was back home, I have this little keyboard. Anytime I'm about to pray, sometimes I end up not praying, but I can sing for over 3 hours in front of my keyboard. My aim is to see that God comes down himself. It's to see that God comes down himself. Amen?
Amen.
Now, that is number one. When you pray, God will send his angels. When you sing and dance and praise God, God will come down himself. himself. That's number one. Number two, 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 14. First Samuel chapter 16, verse 14. The king and all the people with him arrived. Sorry. That is 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 14. Now the spirit of the Lord had departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord had tormented him. Saul attended and said to him, "See, an evil spirit from God is tormenting you. Let our Lord command his servants here to search for someone who can play the lyre. He will play when the evil spirit from God comes upon you, and you will feel better." So Saul said to his servants, "Find me someone who plays well and bring him to me." One of the servants answered, "I have seen a son of Jesse of Bethlehem who knows how to play the lyre. He is brave and a man of warrior. He is a brave man and a warrior. He speaks well and is a fine-looking young man. And the Lord is with him." Then Saul sent messengers to Jesse and said, "Send me your son David, who is with the sheep." And if you go to verse 23, it says, "Whenever the spirit of the devil from God came on Saul, David will take up his lyre and play, and relief will come to Saul, and he will feel better, and his evil spirit will leave him." Now the second one says, "Music can pursue the devil. Music can pursue the devil." Back home, I was after one Sunday, after I had played the keyboard, I went home. A friend of mine who had attended the same service with me called me and said, "I had this problem, but perhaps when I was listening to you play, something happened. Let me stop there." You see, let me tell you the truth. A lot of people have come to me and have said, "Prosper, I beg now, teach me this keyboard now. I said, "No problem, I'll teach you." But eventually, when you discover the reason they want to learn this instrument, you will be discouraged of teaching them. Some of them want to use this to, you know, impress their girlfriends. Some of them want to use this to, you know, just impress people. Is this supposed to be? Why not use this to give God praise? Why not use this to put down the presence of God? Let me show you something else. In the book of 2 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 12. Bible says, "All the Levites who were musicians stood on the east side of the altar, dressed in fine linen, and played cymbals and harps and lyres. They were accompanied by 20 priests sounding trumpets. Then the trumpeters and the musicians joined in unison to give praise and thanks to God, accompanied by trumpets, cymbals, and other instruments. And singers raised their voices in praise to the Lord and sang, 'He is good, His love endures forever.' And while they were doing that, something happened. The temple of the Lord was filled with the cloud. The presence of God was coming. And the priests could not perform their service because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the temple of God." Amen?
Amen.
Now, is music now supposed to be a joke? Sometimes in this world, it hurts me that people just misunderstand and just misuse music. If you look, you will see that music is one thing without so much rules. You are free. You are so free that you can dance from here to here and people will disturb you. It's no problem. And based on that, people are taking it for granted. And a lot of people are falling into temptation and into different terrible things as a consequence of taking it for granted. Music is more than we see. I do not want to go into the academic part of music, but the spiritual part of music here is one thing I would not like to joke with, and I would not like anybody to joke with. Whenever you hear somebody sing, forget the fine voice. It is not about the voice. It is about the message. When somebody says, glorious God, wonderful King, excellent God, worthy to be praised, and is singing, sing. Glorify the name of the Lord. There is something happening in the spiritual that we do not know. And our sister here, there was one thing she did. She said, she be come on her shoe. Say, she feed dance, come on her shoe. Say, make no mind. You see, there is one thing about that thing. You know, the same thing was what David did. And something happened in 2 Samuel chapter 6. Bible says that when the ark of the covenant, the ark of covenant of God came into the palace, came into the through the walls. Bible says David danced and lost control. And as the king, normally he was not supposed to lose control to that extent. Bible says he was half naked. And he was dancing. And no other person would understand why he was dancing. No other person would understand the kind of heart David had. And he was quite appreciative. He was dancing to the glory of God. But his wife, Saul's daughter, Micah, misunderstood this. And so she said, look at you, a king. And began to rebuke David. Bible says, for that, she remained barren until the day she died. That is the consequence. When you see somebody praising God, God does not joke with such a person. And so if you try to joke with such a person, there is a consequence. I mean, it may be worse than barrenness. Because that woman was reported to have been one of the only women, or actually the only woman who never conceived in the Bible. Because the Bible says, none shall be barren among my people. Am I correct? The Bible says, there shall be no one that is barren among my people. But that woman, because of what she did, and it happened after David had explained himself to her and said, I am dancing to the glory of God. Leave me. He said, look at how you are disgracing yourself in front of all these servants, in front of all these slaves. But David said, no, you don't understand. I am dancing to the glory of God. Even if I'm rolling on the ground, God understands. It is one thing to sing. It's another thing to have the heart of praise. You can have a good voice. And you can sing, but nothing is happening. If you understand music and praise God to the level of the spirit, you will know that there is more to music than just singing and just playing the instruments. Sometimes I tell people, no need to practice. No need to practice. I say, when you come up here to praise and worship, no need to practice. If you understand to the spiritual realm, the level of the spirit, how God sees music, you don't need to practice. God will lead you. God will take over. Sometimes you write down songs. Hey, I'll sing this one. I'll sing this one today. I'll sing this one. After this one, I'll sing this one. And eventually, you see yourself singing number 10 first. And maybe another thing that is not even written. It is God leading you. If you allow God to lead you, He will. But perhaps if you try to write down something and you try to follow it, you may follow it, but you are missing something. Something is missing. The presence of God may be absent. So music is more than just the voice, the singing. It's about understanding. It is because David understood, that's when he wrote about 150 psalms just to praise God. I wonder how we will be singing. I wonder how we will sing 150 times. Bible recorded that whenever the evil spirit came upon Saul, David would bring his life, his heart, and start playing. And what will happen? That evil spirit will depart from Saul. What does that explain? This is not an ordinary thing. Whenever we begin to sing, whenever we begin to praise, we are actually going beyond the natural. We are going into the supernatural. Only God can explain it, and only the people who are in spirit can understand it. Anytime we are singing, not at anybody, don't look at anybody, close your eyes and pray. Appreciate God. I tell you, there is, when it comes to praising, there is nothing like appreciating God. Okay. Sometimes when I appreciate God, jokingly, I feel that God is like, who is doing this? This is wonderful. This is nice. Let me find him. That is where I see it. And I feel that God is sending down, arranging my blessings for me and come to present it to me himself. If you begin to understand it this way, the voice you hear does not matter. You don't have to let people sing for you, no matter how terrible your voice is. Sing to God. God will do it for you. You. Most of the times, sometimes, to tell you the truth, I am bored to pray. I don't know. It may be very bad. But I substitute it with something. I sing very much. Everywhere. I sing anyhow, anytime. I'm singing. And people catch me singing because I'm not always singing. And sometimes I'm washing my clothes and I'm like, oh God, Jesus. And people just open the door and catch me. It's because of this understanding that by the grace of God I have. And if we are to key into this, we will see that music is not ordinary. If any one of you will understand this, then we will start worshiping God in another dimension. In church at home, sometimes we sing for about 3 hours and then we say the grace. We just sing and dance and people will be sweating. And our spiritual leader will tell us and say, if you don't sweat in praising God, you sweat in making money. Say, if you dance and you don't dwell in making in praising God, you will suffer and sweat. Bring out that sweat while making your money. And all about making money. I've told people and said, I will not go for money. I will stand and money will come to me. That is the way it should be. For the people of God, the mistake that people make nowadays is that they run after money. And you know, if you run after money, you are scaring money. And money is running away from you. And all the days of your life, you will keep chasing money. And the mistake, the one thing about it is that if you keep chasing money, definitely you will get money. But you will keep chasing money till you die. And your offspring will come and continue chasing the money. And the one thing that is bad about chasing money is that it will derail you. You will no longer follow what God says. There is a place recorded in the Bible that says, wealth comes from me. Wealth comes from me. Which means if you want to get this wealth, look up. No, they chase money. Money will come to you. As a child of God, money will come to me. Sorry, I digress, but that is one thing that praise can do. Once you start praising God, you will stop chasing money. Money will start coming. I'm not saying you will become lazy. I'm saying you will be doing everything you are supposed to do, and money will be coming to you. Praise God. Those that chase money are the lovers of money, and the love of money is the root of all evil. But money is not the root of evil. Am I making sense? Money is not the root of all evil, but the love of money is the root of all evil. Amen. By the end of this, we would ask God and say, God, give me the spirit of praise. One thing that David had that I love is the spirit of praise. Perhaps that is one reason that God says, David is a man after my own heart. Because his son Solomon also got that trait from him. Solomon wrote Songs of Solomon, am I correct? Yes. And so it is, you see, one thing is that God opened the eyes of David and he wrote Psalms. Psalm is not something ordinary. David wrote things about the New Testament in the Old Testament. David also wrote about Jesus Christ in his Psalms, without his, even perhaps without his own knowledge. If you sing with God, if you sing, that, you know, there is a difference when you see somebody that is singing because he has a good voice and somebody that is singing to bring down the presence of God. Sometimes when you are in church, suddenly you feel a move in your body while they are singing, while somebody is singing. That person singing is beyond natural. That person is going beyond natural. He's going beyond what we can see. Sometimes we take some songs for granted. Like, worthy, you are worthy, King of kings, Lord of lords, you are someone sings this and kneels and raises his hand and starts waving. In the spirit, he closes his eyes and is calling God and says, Father, you are worthy. You are worthy. It is now beyond natural. It is now supernatural. But I think you have to have the talent first. You have to have the talent first. And that is why it is not a sin if I take the mic from you when you are singing nonsense. So if God has, what my point is, if God has given you this talent, use it for God. Do not enter the studio and start describing people's. If you want to do that, there is anatomy. Am I correct? Of course. If you want to do that, enter medicine. Do medicine. Study it in anatomy. I mean, it's very easy. But for you to enter studio and start singing about the the bodacious secondary characteristics of a woman is with the talent God has given to you. I don't know. It's between you and God. I cannot tell you anything. But it is good to praise God. It is good to praise God. I tell you, if you understand this, sometimes you will just sing from morning till night. And I tell you, things are changing. Sometimes, after about 3 hours of singing, after closing my eyes and singing, when you open your eyes, you feel like you are not in that location, like you have just arrived. Sometimes I'm kneeling and my hands are on my keyboard, that is at home. My eyes are on my keyboard and I'm closing my eyes and I'm playing and I'm singing. Sometimes somebody comes and sees me, perhaps my mom will come and see me and they will go. And another person will come and see me and I will go and they will go. And how I will know that they came to see me is that they will tell me, because I will never know. Why? Because sometimes I'm not even there. Sometimes you will open your eyes and you will say, is this really my room? That is what praise can do. That is what worship can do. I don't know. There is this understanding that God has about praise, about worship. Bible says they went round the walls of Jericho singing and dancing, and the walls of Jericho came down by themselves. It is not it has no natural explanation. It is what God can do. So why would I enter the studio and sing rubbish? Why not use my beautiful voice and glorify God? Why not spend my time composing beautiful songs for God? Mixing Igbo with English and Yoruba to praise God. Amen. Let's sing this. Let the praise of God be in two places, your mouth and in your hands. Now what does the praise of God do? Number one, verse 7, to inflict vengeance on the nations and punishment on the people, to bind their kings with fetters, their nobles with shackles of iron, to carry out sentence written against them. This is the glory of all his faithful people. Praise God. That is praise. Praise is like sword. Praise is that sword. It's beyond your voice. It's now in your hands that you could use against all enemies. So, if you are singing, know that you are not, it is no longer physical. It has gone beyond physical. It is now spiritual. Do not sing to please people. Do not sing for people to eventually tell you, hey, you have a very wonderful voice. And then you sing so that they will know that you have a very wonderful voice. The truth of the matter is that I repented from that. I had to repent from that. Because every day by day, God is teaching you. He's showing you new things. He's giving you more experiences. So, it is not okay. It is not good. It is bad for you to be singing God's song, for people to be clapping for you, for people to be praising you. Bible says, God will never share his glory with anybody. The glory must be unto God. Every glory must be unto God. And that is why, sorry, if I must say, I don't usually say thank you when people say you have a very nice voice. I simply laugh. Because it is not because I don't like it. It is not because it is not good to be appreciated, but just based on the understanding I have, what I do is for God. And if all glory must be unto God, I would not need any glory. We don't need glory. You know that. God needs glory. God says, give me all the glory. It is mine. So praise God in his sanctuary, in the firmament of his power. Today we are going to pray. We are going to say, God, bestow upon me the spirit of praise. I tell you the truth. If God bestows upon us the spirit of praise, something will change. I assure you, something will change. I am talking from experience. God has taught me so much. If God bestows upon you the spirit of praise, something will change. I'm thinking of a song. Song. So forget about yourself and concentrate on him and worship him. So forget about every of your problems, forget about your problems, situations, and worship. Forget about that thing that is troubling you. Forget about that thing that gives you sleepless nights. Forget about it. God is able to do what he says he will do. All you need to do is forget it and just worship it. That's all. God is able to do it, even more than we can ever ask. When we God will calm down himself. When we praise, God will calm down himself. Why not say, God, give me that spirit of David. Give me that spirit. given to David. Give me the understanding about praise, that I may begin to understand music beyond the natural, that I may take it to the understanding of the supernatural.
Your heart that God sees, God looks at your heart. What is your heart? Why are you praising Him? Hallelujah. So it's good to praise God. I remember, I think last year I was in Zaporozhye. Everybody used to make jest of me that I can't sing. You know, that I normally sing off key. Even as I was leading the song, I knew I was singing off key. But I persisted. I was singing. And before you know it, the presence of God just came. If I have not done that, what do you think? I was singing, but I noticed that I was singing off key, but I persisted. I was just singing. Because God sees the content of my heart. Hallelujah. And as I was singing, the presence of God just came. So, it's not about how good your voice is, but about your heart. And in praising God, we talk several times that God is the holy audience. Hallelujah. So when you're praising God, don't look at the person that is standing beside you. Just lift up your name, God, and praise God. God! Hallelujah. So it's good to praise God. So when you use the talent that God has given you to praise God, God will look for you. But when you use it the other way around, the devil what? Will look for you. Hallelujah. So that's why you need to listen to gospel, you cannot listen to worldly songs. When you listen to worldly songs, the devil will chase you. But when you listen to gospel music, Christian music, God will be the one looking what for you, because what, you are a praiser. Hallelujah. And Paul was saying in Romans chapter 2, he said, I beseech you that, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto the Lord, which is what? Your reasonable word, service. Hallelujah. That means we should use what? In what? To praise what? The Lord. Hallelujah. So it is good to praise the Lord. Let us just commit the person that God has used for us into God's hands, that God will increase in, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. That Lord, we pray that you bless your son. That Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. That Lord, we pray, everlasting Father, Lord, that the talents you have given unto him, that all the days of his life, he shall use it to the praise of your name, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. That Lord, we pray, Father, you shall expand his ministry, Lord, in the name of Jesus. That Lord, we bless you and we give you all the glory. Blessed be your name, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. For in Jesus' precious name we pray. Hallelujah.